Gerald Ford is the only American ever to become Vice President of the United States, other than as the result of a national election. This is actually a point of purely clerical interest, because it is not disputed that if Richard Nixon had named Mr. Ford as the desired vice presidential candidate at Miami either in 1968 or 1972, he'd have been ardently embraced by his party and, one supposes, the electorate. If Mr. Nixon had secretly wanted to name someone this last time around who probably couldn't have made it through the normal electoral processes, he didn't take this opportunity to do it. Gerald Ford, having been intensively investigated in the atmosphere of what his predecessor called the post-Watergate morality, was confirmed all but unanimously. Ironically, and perhaps significantly, one of the very few congressmen who didn't vote for him was Congressman Rodino, who now heads the Judiciary Committee that is considering the impeachment of Richard Nixon. Since assuming office, Mr. Ford has been criticized both for doing too little and doing too much, for talking too frequently to newsmen and not frequently enough. The jokes about him have begun to wear thin. For a while, his critics ran with the football image. And indeed, Mr. Ford was something of a football hero at the University of Michigan and was an assistant coach at the Yale Law School. But that wore a little thin after a while. They have said about him that he is ambitious, that in 1965 he took the Republican leadership away from Charles Halleck. But then, of course, all incumbents take the office from previous incumbents. They have frequently reminded us that he once said that impeachment is what the House says it is, referring to the impeachment proceedings he brought against Justice William Douglas. They say he has zigzagged on the matter of Nixon and the tapes, which is true, and he got a football metaphor out of it. He began his career as vice president by beating Teddy Kennedy in a straw poll, but nowadays he trails Kennedy in a straw poll. It is generally agreed that he is accessible, that he knows and likes Congress, that he is, of course, clean as a hound's tooth, and that taking everything into consideration, he is the likeliest man in the United States to be the next president of the United States. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Ford, in the event that you become president, would you grant amnesty to everyone involved in the so-called Watergate affair?
I'm not sure, Bill, that I ought to undertake to respond to a question of that kind. In the first place, I don't anticipate becoming president. And to speculate in such a sensitive area without knowing who might be convicted and who might be acquitted, I think would be presumptuous and ill-advised.
Well, I don't want to ask you anything that would embarrass you in any way, but tell me if you think the question thus formulated is illegitimate. Mightn't there come a point in the American travail when it makes sense to Republicans and to Democrats to close this particular chapter? And if it happened that at that moment you were uniquely possessed of the authority to do so, would you consider using it?
First, I don't think the question was illegitimate. I only took the position that I did because, as I said a moment ago, you don't know, I don't know, no one really knows who out of the 10 or 12, whatever the number is, will be acquitted and who will be convicted. We had Maury Stans and John Mitchell acquitted in New York a month or so ago. Many people thought they were going to be convicted. A jury of 12 decided they were innocent. And for me, number one, to catapult myself into the office of president and then make a decision with so many uncertainties, I think would be very ill-advised. If the circumstances develop that I am in that position, I can only say that each and every case would be judge strictly on its merits.
Well, Mr. Vice President, let's see if we can, with any success, transact very early in this hour certain psychological problems that you have, with which I'm extremely sympathetic. If you were, let's say, not Gerald Ford, Vice President of the United States under these rather delicate circumstances, but say George McGovern 3 years ago, campaigning to be President of the United States, he would eagerly say, if I were President, I would do such and such. And nobody in this audience or anywhere else would think that this was a breach of taste, would they? Is it possible to address you as somebody to whom one can ask questions, this is what I, Gerald Ford, would do if I were President, without somehow giving the impression that by entertaining such questions, you somehow come out on the anti-Nixon side of the Watergate ledger?
I don't think my refusal to testify or to make a comment here is anti-Nixon.
I don't either.
In fact, it might, I think it's completely neutral. I just have the very strong conviction that something that is as important as amnesty for any person who is convicted, I don't think you can just pull the answer out of the blue sky. First, you have to know who the person is. You have to know what the conviction was for. You have to get reports from the proper authorities investigating the background, and to discuss a matter of this consequence with so many uncertainties, I think is just ill-advised. I have no hesitancy to talk about policy.
Sure.
Foreign policy, domestic policy.
Sure.
But to get into this area, catapulting myself through your question and my answer into a position that I don't have and probably won't get,
right,
I think is an area where I should refrain from comment.
Sure. I can understand your reacting that way, though I'm a little disappointed.
Well, I'm sorry I've disappointed you, but I have to use a little good judgment here, you know.
Of course. But now, if the president were here, Mr. Nixon, and if he were to say, look, if I, the president of the United States, become convinced as a result of evidence that is forthcoming at trials, and we've got, a couple dozen coming up in the next few months, that this entire radius, this entire network of operatives understood themselves, however unwittingly and however incorrectly, to be acting as agents of the commander-in-chief, I would therefore grant them amnesty in recognition of the fact that they were misled. Now, would you find this a politically offensive conclusion of his, or do you think it's one the American people would find understandable?
I have reservations that any of the people who I think you're thinking about were misled in any way. They were all grown, mature people. Many of them had had not only college, but graduate educations. Many of them came from fine backgrounds. I don't think under any circumstances...
You're not saying only dumb people get misled, are you?
Well, a lot of people get misled.
Look at all those people who voted for McGovern.
Well, I share their being misled, but unfortunately...
You mean you share the conclusion that they were misled?
Both that they were misled and they were small in number.
Yeah, but Professor Galbraith has a very fine background, for instance.
Well, he obviously made a serious mistake.
Okay, so he was misled, right? Well, now we know, for instance, that Charles Colson is a college graduate and a lawyer, and I happen to accept, without reservation, his statement that he has been converted to Christianity. And he says, I understood myself to be acting in behalf of the President of the United States. Now, since you and I presumably know that he wasn't, then he was misled, right?
Well, let me put it this way. Chuck Colson has some I presume, some very important testimony to give.
Right.
He's never actually testified in public under oath, and I hope that he is given an opportunity to tell his story publicly on television, on radio, for the benefit of the news media, and...
You don't doubt that he will?
I certainly hope not.
Oh, you mean if his lawyers tell him not to, is that what you mean?
No, I'm trying to make sure that he does have this opportunity, because I think he undoubtedly can clarify many things. And I can't tell you at this point whether he's for or against the president, but I think it's a vitally important ingredient in this impeachment process that not only Colson and but Dean and the rest of them testify before the House Committee on the Judiciary, before the full news media. And then we'll know whether they were misled or whether mm-hmm. they were directed mm-hmm. or just what the circumstances were.
But if it should transpire that they understood themselves to be acting for the Commander-in-Chief, if they convinced you of it, would you then say that the American people, Democrats and Republicans alike, would sympathize with any movement by President Nixon to grant amnesty?
Well, it seems to me, Bill, that a person such as those we've talked about or thinking about, if they were in a position where they were going to commit an act where if they were caught would be a crime, I don't think they showed the best of judgment by not finding out from the boss himself, instead of saying that somebody told them this or allegedly said that. You know, the commission of a crime, at least under my standards, is a pretty serious offense.
Yes, sir.
And for someone to commit a crime or to commit an act if caught would be a crime, and then say, well, I thought somebody was telling me this, I think there's some reason to have reservations about their judgment.
Yes, sir, I do too. But I heard last summer, maybe you did, a very highly respected attorney here in Washington, John Wilson, testifying before the Irvin Committee. And John Wilson said, in my opinion, as a lawyer of 40 years' experience, the President of the United States does have a transcendent authority, for instance, to order, if he believes that the national security is involved, a break-in of a psychiatrist's office. Now, there was a number of boos in the audience, but those weren't necessarily the boos of the collective legal wisdom of America. As I understand it, the case can be made for certain transcendent authority. Jefferson appealed to it. Lincoln appealed
to it. Let me say this. Yes, I
so
think
it
any
isn't
president,
just dumb people.
No, I think any president, Bill, under his constitutional authorities as a commander-in-chief for the protection of our national security can order certain rather drastic actions, including a break-in, whether it would be justified for the break-in of a psychiatrist's office of a man who had given away, contrary to law, classified documents. I'm not sure I would carry the case of the president's authority as far as Dr. Fielding's responsibility, but here you had Ellsberg, obviously, and I think admittedly, giving away classified government secrets involving national security. And in my judgment, if those documents were of sufficient importance to our national defense, I think the president, in that case, probably had authority to direct action in that way. But whether it's a case, whether he could make a case for some psychiatrist, Dr. Ellsberg's another matter.
Well, do you think that the integrity of the process would then require the president to grant amnesty to somebody who did his bidding on the president's word? In other words, if the president said to Colson or whoever, look, take it from me as commander-in-chief that I believe that there are grounds for supposing that there is national security a problem here, and therefore I authorize you to break that law which we know otherwise exists.
Bill, I think we're getting into an area where you're setting up such a hypothetical case
yeah.
where we don't know the facts. I think I'm having even more reservations about making any comment concerning this matter because, number one, we don't know what Colson's going to say. We don't know what other witnesses may say about their relationship to the president.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and at least in my case, and I hope you'll forgive me, I just don't think that I ought to commit myself at this particular point.
Okay. All right, now let me ask you this, Ms. Vice President. The fact that you are Vice President does not and ought not to make you any of the less partisan a Republican, right?
Absolutely not. Okay. Every other Vice President that I know of has campaigned for Democrats or Republicans equally, and I think that's a part of the responsibility. I think that's part of our two-party system.
I agree. Last time you were on this program, which was 1968, you twice made it a point to refer to, quote, the problems of the Johnson-Humphrey administration, because you didn't want the American people to forget that Humphrey was in some way implicated.
He was
in
a part
Johnson.
Of the team.
That's right. And you're a part of the Nixon.
Right.
Team.
I'm proud of it.
Yeah, I know you are. I know you are. Now, here's what I want to ask you. And let's agree to be very grown up about this, right? That Republicans are having a hell of a time right now because of Watergate. Even your successor in a seat that was thought to be totally secure is now a Democrat.
Right.
Now, if it should happen in the next 2 or 3 weeks that counting noses, and I take it nobody is better at this than you because of your vast experience on the Hill, if, let's say, on a Tuesday, you absolutely predict that the president's going to lose and that he's going to be impeached, leaving aside the question of what the Senate does, wouldn't it be a good idea for you to urge the president, to urge all Republican congressmen in the House to vote for impeachment so as not to leave any of them in exposed positions? That way they can go back to Orange County or wherever and say, sure, I voted for impeachment, but the president asked me to. The president asked me to because he felt that there were some unresolved constitutional issues that needed to be adjudicated by the Senate.
I can't imagine a more or less courageous thing for a member of the House to do. I mean, they're elected to pass judgment. And it seems to me that if the Committee on Judiciary does vote out an impeachment resolution, and the odds are probably that the committee will, then 435 members, less the 38 members on the Committee on the Judiciary, will have to make up their mind. And they took an oath of office to make some decisions. And for them to say, no, I'm not going to make a decision here, I'm going to turn it over to 100 senators. I can't imagine a member of the House being so irresponsible or so lacking in courage.
I'm sure they won't. In the first place, a day doesn't go by that the President of the United States doesn't ask Congress to do something.
Oh, well, of course.
He turns them and says, you should vote for this bill or you will be sorry and history will despise you.
But presidents don't always get their way.
No, I'm not saying, and I'm not suggesting that every member of the House should follow the president's advice. What I'm saying is that if it becomes clear that the president is going to be impeached, is there a hell of a lot of point in your sending these poor derelicts back to seek re-election, with their constituencies divided, 50% of them sore as hell because they voted for impeachment, another 50% sore as hell if they didn't vote for impeachment, guaranteeing, if we follow the precedents of the last few weeks, a decimated Republican House, simply because
of
this point of pride.
You're assuming some things that aren't necessarily true and I don't think will be true. In the first place, I'm not at all sure, even if the Committee on Judiciary should vote out an impeachment resolution, we'll say 21-17. And I don't think it'll be any worse than that under any circumstances. But supposing it does come out 21-17, you've got 435 members, less the 38 on the committee they, having already made up their mind.
I have a feeling you're familiar with the arithmetic.
Well, I learned by old math, you see, and I never could learn the new math. But anyhow, it seems to me that a member of the House who was not on that committee ought to have the wisdom and the courage and the good judgment to sit there as a jury and pass judgment on the evidence that has been accumulated in that committee. For a Republican particularly, to duck the issue, I think has more political hazards than showing a little courage to vote yes or no. If a Republican voted for impeachment just because he thought it would help him politically, I don't think that Republican would come back under any circumstances. And how you can believe in the legislative process, and I know you do, and then expect 187 Republicans to abandon that responsibility is beyond my comprehension.
No, I'm not really raising a point of courage. I mean, the 600 in Tennyson's poem had courage.
They went down in fame.
That's right. They went down in fame. And if the Republicans in the House of Representatives are going to go down, I guess I just assume they went down in fame. But I'd assume they didn't go down either.
Well, I'm delighted to hear that.
As a consumer, an
American
consumer.
Let me just take one other thing where I think you're dead wrong. You're assuming that...
I don't think I can be dead wrong because I've only talked about assumptions.
Well, then you're...
I haven't made any
predictions. Dead wrong in the assumptions because I don't think
it's... You can't be wrong in an assumption.
if it leads to the wrong conclusion.
Oh.
I don't happen to think the Republicans are going to be devastated, smashed, wiped out come November. You may not have noticed it because it's somewhat parochial to Michigan. But you remember the 8th District fight which followed the loss of my congressional seat. The Democrat who won, Representative Traxler in the state legislature, they had a special election this last week to fill his representative seat. They had a 22-year-old Republican, a gal. The young ladies out in this audience ought to appreciate that. She beat the Democrat 2-1 in the most powerfully Democratic area in that 8th congressional district. And we won another state representative seat, I think a state senator, in an area which had been a marginal area. What I'm saying is, don't count, well, I'm not saying to you because you said you were for Republicans coming back, but if I were the Democrats who are predicting a net gain of 50 or a net gain of 100, they hadn't better count their chickens before they're hatched. I happen to think the American people are not going to buy a legislative dictatorship, which is what you would end up with if you had a smashing Democratic victory in the elections in 1974.
And I happen to think you're saying what you're saying because it sounds good.
Well,
and it's very reassuring. I heard you predict the victory of your successor who lost.
Well,
and you said it just as convincingly then as what you've just said now.
Do you remember back in 1966 when we were outnumbered in the House 295 to 140, and I said that Republicans in the 66 election would make a net gain of 45. We made a net gain of 47. So my batting average in this area is pretty good. And I just hope my very good Democratic friends keep on predicting that they are going to get a veto-proof Congress, that they're going to get a legislative dictatorship, because I think they're going to be disappointed. They ought not to count those chickens before they're hatched.
No. I agree, but it's also true, Mr. Ford, that if you take the figures of 1974 in those six elections and project them to November, we lose 100 seats.
Well, figures can be very misleading, and I'd rather depend on the candidates. And I think we've got some excellent incumbents on the Republican side who will...
I do, too.
...will do surprisingly well. Now, in the meantime, I think you have to recognize that the president has done some very, very successful things in the area of foreign policy, things that no Democrat president has ever done. The Middle East, I think that's a tremendous step forward for peace. I think the president, when he comes back from the Soviet Union, will also have some accomplishments that will be beneficial. No Democrat president has ever accomplished as much in the field of foreign policy as President Nixon. I think this is a good, honest campaign issue. And I happen to think there will be some other pluses.
I think if Richard Nixon went to the cellar of the White House tomorrow and discovered a cure for cancer, the Washington Post would not notice it.
The Washington Post only has any real circulation in this area.
But I use it as a symbol. I use it as a symbol, and I can experience and share in your frustration, even if I read foreign affairs a little bit differently, and a little bit more pessimistically than you. But take somebody like Senator Dole. I know that you have a high opinion of him.
I certainly do.
Because for one thing, you had a hand in making him chairman of the Republican Party.
Right.
Now it's only a week ago. The Senator Dole says, I don't know how I'm going to make it. He said, because any reference I make to Mr. Nixon, if there's an inflection of harshness in it, I get angry mail from the loyalists who say, I wouldn't vote for you if you were the last man in Kansas. Or if I make any reference to Mr. Nixon that is considered too sycophantic, I get angry mail. Have you no regard for American standards and so on and so forth? Now, I don't know how to help Senator Dole out, because he's in the Senate. But I do think that Senator Dole's situation is reproduced in the House 100 times. And that if indeed, this is an assumption, mind, if indeed you figure out that you're going to lose in the House, why don't you counsel people to make it unanimous? And simply say, all right, we're going to the Senate because there is an unresolved point having to do with executive privilege. And this way, they can go back and say, well, we're fighting a constitutional point and escape the vindictiveness of the loyalists or the anti-Nixon people.
In the first place, the issue of executive privilege is going to be decided by the Supreme Court.
Not necessarily. Well, because your St. Clair says that the Supreme Court really doesn't have any right to pass on the judgment.
They're
Remember
going
that.
To make a judgment whether the president was right or not in refusing to release the tape.
And St. Clair's position is that whatever the Supreme Court says really is irrelevant.
Well, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
Well, how will you cross it then?
Well, we'll wait and see. I'm sure we'll get across. But now, the other point I think that's important, here you have a constitutional process. Can you imagine those 55 men who drafted the Constitution looking down from the good heavens and saying, my, all those 187 Republicans refused to at least participate in the process? I don't think any Republican ought to stand by and not participate. Now, there's one other assumption where I think you're wrong. You're talking as though a decision in this instance, whether the president ought to be impeached or not, would only be harmful or difficult for a Republican. You talk to some Democrats in the House of Representatives, whether they're Northern or Southern, and I'll admit that it's more of a problem for Southern Democrats. They think it's a no-win issue, too. And consequently, if you're giving the advice to me to tell the Republicans to cop out, you ought to advise the Democrats to do the same. And then you'd really have a potent legislative body in the House of Representatives. They ought to dock their pay if they do.
Do you remember that this was done on the censure of Joe McCarthy?
Well, I don't recall that. The House never acted on that.
No, the Senate did.
Well, this is a totally different process. This is impeachment.
Everything's different. Everything's different. The point is that they decided that they would all vote against Joe McCarthy, even the conservative Democrats, because that way there would be no residual exposure.
Well, now, they were wrong, if I might respectfully say so.
They may very well have been wrong, but they lost no seats 2 years later.
Well, what year was that? It was 1952 or 54.
Yeah. 54. Now, but my point is that as I continue to refer to myself as a consumer, what you people do in Washington, I am a consumer of. And I would much rather see X number of Republicans sent back to the White House, to the Congress, because having escaped the wrath of the loyalists or the anti-loyalists, if they took what I consider to be an honorable out by saying, all right, the public is confused on a constitutional point, and the Senate's going to have to decide on it. Is this something that you reject right to the end?
I certainly would. I don't think a member of the House ought to cop out. I don't think a member of the House ought to fail to participate in a constitutionally established procedure.
Why is it copping out? Suppose you were Raoul Berger sitting over here, and I'm Alexander Bickel sitting over here, and we disagree on the meaning of executive privilege. Now, why should we expect the average congressman to know more than Professor Berger or Professor Bickel? So why can't the congressman say, well, since I don't know which side is correct on this issue, we really need, in effect, the kind of clarification that can only be provided at the other end of an impeachment proceeding?
Well, let me ask you this. You aren't inferring that 100 senators are more knowledgeable than 435 members of the House, do you?
Not necessarily. Well,
I can't believe that you would, but...
I'm talking about you.
Because there is a step-by-step process. And after all, it is quite possible, and I happen to think at this point it is likely, that the House of Representatives will make the final decision, that it'll never get to the members of the United States Senate.
This isn't campaign talk.
No, this is an honest evaluation. And as you said a moment ago, I've had little experience and I have not a bad batting average in counting votes in the House of Representatives.
But you also had experience in pep talks in the middle of a house.
Yes, but you and I are talking very pragmatically and I'm not trying
to
kid any. And it's my judgment as of the moment on the basis of the circumstances as I see them today. Even if the Committee on the Judiciary should vote out a resolution favoring impeachment. I don't think there are votes enough in the House of Representatives to convict the president, I mean, to impeach the president. In the first place, it's pretty obvious, and I've talked to Democrats and Republicans in the House and some on the committee. They have no impeachable offense on the milk deal. In fact, the impact of milk is so broad in this whole situation that I don't think the committee or the House or the Senate would ever dare impeach the president on this one. And on ITT, I see nothing, and no one else really says it's an impeachable offense. No one contends that knows anything about it that the president was involved in the planning or the execution of the break-in of the Democratic National Headquarters. You really come right down to one issue.
The cover-up.
The alleged cover-up.
Yeah, that's right.
And so...
No, the cover-up, his alleged participation in it.
Yes, yeah. Right, the cover... that's more accurate, I agree. But so far, I don't think there is sufficient evidence to contend as an impeachable offense that the president was involved in the alleged cover-up, or in the cover. Now, this is what 435 members of the House have to decide. I don't think there are enough that'll vote for it.
Yes, sir, but what if, to add to the point that you've just triangulated on, you got the vexed question that the Supreme Court is going to visit on it. Suppose the Supreme Court rules against us. Can I say us?
Sure.
Suppose it rules against us. Then the Judiciary Committee might vote on contumacious grounds.
I agree.
Right.
And that's why I most carefully, Bill,
that's why I say a constitutional implications, right?
But that's why I most carefully said on the basis of facts as they exist today. I think the decision of the United States Supreme Court, the appeal of Jaworski, action of the president in saying that a non-indictable allegation by the grand jury. I mean, if those issues are adversely determined by the Supreme Court and the president then decides to refuse to cooperate,
then
I think it's a totally different ballgame.
In that case, would you urge the House of Representatives, if you thought it was going to go that way anyway, to go 100%?
I don't understand you wanting to tell 435 members of the House or 187 Republicans to say, gee, all the wisdom exists over in the other body, as we call it, don't do anything.
Not, I mean, not, because not wisdom, it, power.
Well, I'd rather have integrity than power.
Look, the American people all of a sudden agreed, as recently as a few weeks ago, to skip all of the judges in the Court of Appeals. Why? Because they wanted the agency that had the power, the Supreme Court, to go ahead and transact this terribly delicate issue. Now, this doesn't mean that we all have to sit around saying all judges who sit on the Court of Appeals are dumb or incompetent. It simply says that in the last analysis, we may as well get a verdict. Now, I don't see why a courageous, intellectually respectable congressman mightn't say, okay, I reserved myself the right to decide whether Nixon is a chicken thief. But we're not talking about that. We're not talking about a thing called executive prerogative. And here, I recognize that the court of last resort is the Senate. And therefore, I'm going to pass it on to the Senate. Meanwhile, having a fighting chance to return to Congress without being crucified back home because I was too much pro-Nixon.
I think you're advocating a policy of pure political expediency.
Boy, oh boy, I'm delighted I discovered it at last. I've been resisting it all my life.
I know it. And it seems to me that, in fact, it surprises me that you advocate such expediency for a person who only wants to come back so that he can collect his salary and continue his career. He ought to have a little gumption and a little forthrightness and be willing to take the chances. Now,
it's a lucky thing Mr. Nixon never discovered political expediency. It aborted his career, huh?
Well, it seems to me that for a member of the House, Republican, as well as some Democrats, perhaps, to say, well, I'm just going to duck it. I'm going to run out in the cloakroom and not hear the bells when they ring for a roll call. It would be real tough for that fellow to go back home. And somebody will get up in the audience and say, well, how did you vote on the impeachment? About that time, he had run out the back door because he knew he would know exactly what the next question would be. Well, didn't you make up an independent judgment as you swore to do under when you took the oath of office?
Now, wait a minute. What did you swear to do?
To uphold the Constitution. The Constitution gives the House of Representatives a constitutional responsibility.
But nobody knows what the Constitution is at this point. The Supreme Court, about whom the White House says it exercises no responsibility, is telling you to do something. Congress is telling you to do something. The White House is saying that the Congress has no responsibility to tell the White House to do that. Nobody knows what the Constitution is.
Well,
it becomes purely a matter of fact politique.
No,
who has the raw power to prevail?
But a member of the House, having taken an oath of office, in his best judgment, to uphold the Constitution, doesn't carry out that responsibility, in my judgment, by saying, well, I won't make that decision. There are 100 senators over there who are more qualified than I to do this. And I just think...
But can't he say, I don't know?
I am
he puzzled.
He is an elected person to make a decision.
He's an elected person whose job it is to take an oath to defend the Constitution. But the Constitution has built into it certain ambiguities. And the only method of adjudicating these ambiguities right now is up in the air. Some people, you usually say, well, let the Supreme Court tell us. But now we've got a situation in which the President of the United States has not acknowledged that the Supreme Court has authority to tell him.
Well, he is exercising his legal right to take an appeal to the higher court or the higher courts, and because under the importance of this issue, the Supreme Court reached down and said, we're going to take it from the district court and decide it ourselves rather than having it go through the Circuit Court of Appeals. That's a perfectly proper procedure that is very frequently used in our judicial system when major constitutional issues are involved. Now, the members of the House are equally a part of a legitimate constitutional sequence.
Mm-hmm.
And for them to abandon their responsibilities, I think, would be incomprehensible and furthermore, I think, lead to political suicide.
So you insist on calling it abandonment?
Or cop-out, or political expediency. Yeah. I don't care what term you use. They're all used in the same context.
You would not liken it to going to recognizing that you do not, in fact, have the authority yourself, and that under the circumstances you must.
Well, the Constitution gives him that authority to act on an impeachable offense. You see, a member of the House has to go back basically to the Constitution. And the Constitution says, and the language is very precise in the case of a president, treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors. Now, if the Supreme Court decides adversely to the president, that member of the House then has to decide for himself whether a refusal to obey an order of the Supreme Court falls within that very clear definition of impeachment.
Mm-hmm.
And for him to say, well, I don't know, and turn it over to 100 senators, I must say I don't understand.
When you were arguing for the impeachment of Justice Douglas, you phrased the argument.
I'm glad you brought that up. I said that an impeachable offense is whatever the House of Representatives decides.
Yeah.
I still believe that.
Yeah.
As a matter
so it's consistent with what you've been saying.
That's correct. I must say I used it in a little different context because an impeachable offense for a president is very clear-cut. Treason, bribery, other high crimes and misdemeanors. Impeachment for a federal judge is predicated on different grounds.
Are they specified?
No. The Constitution says that a federal judge shall be appointed during good behavior. And it doesn't define what is bad behavior, or it doesn't define what is good behavior either.
But
case of a federal judge, the House of Representatives has to take a look at a judge's behavior, not any specific criminal act, treason, bribery, high crimes, or misdemeanors. So in the case of a federal judge, the House is in effect passing on a judge's good behavior,
right,
not on a specific crime.
Yeah, so in other words, the specific crimes for which a president can be impeached go beyond misbehavior.
Well, there, misbehavior, I mean, for a president isn't necessarily an impeachable offense.
Correct.
In the Constitution, an impeachable offense for the president is very categorical and specific. It's not that clear-cut in the case of a federal judge.
Mr. Robert Kuttner is with the Washington Post. Mr. Kuttner.
Mr. Vice President, I believe you said that based on what you know now, you would expect that the House would probably not vote to impeach, but that if the President were to reject a decision of the Supreme Court, it would probably be a totally different ballgame.
I don't think you did say that, actually.
Yes, I did.
Did you? I thought earlier you said you expected impeachment.
Judiciary Committee, but
Judiciary
not House.
Judiciary Committee. Yeah.
Oh, Judiciary Committee, I see.
He's talking about the
House. Can I pin you down on that a bit? You would then expect that if the president were to flout a decision of the court, that the House might well impeach?
I think, excuse me, it then becomes an institutional confrontation, not a confrontation predicated on the language of the Constitution. And anytime you get an institutional confrontation, in my judgment, it's quite a different vote for a member of the House.
Mm-hmm. Well, based on that, and you do talk to the president from time to time, why do you think he has declined to pledge in advance that he would abide by a decision of the court?
Some months earlier, I think about 4 months ago, he said that he would abide by a definitive decision of the Supreme Court. Those were the precise words that he used. Now, I don't think he's gone beyond it. I don't think he's subtracted from it. And I don't believe that anybody who's involved in litigation, including a president, ought to say in advance just what their conduct will be, because what they say might be prejudicial to the case that they are pursuing under their legal rights.
But doesn't it go without saying that you abide by the Supreme Court?
Well, if you assume, by the way you asked the question, that a president would, then I shouldn't have to answer. What I'm saying is that I believe the president ought to abide by the decision. I have no hesitancy to say that. Although I don't know what the decision is going to be, because the court hasn't made up its mind.
But there obviously is some question in the public mind at this point whether the president will, because his spokesmen have specifically declined to reiterate his earlier pledge.
Well, I can understand that. A person who's involved in very serious litigation doesn't want to prejudice his case one way or another.
It makes it too easy for the court, right?
supposing he said in advance, I don't care what the Supreme Court decides. Let them go ahead and deliberate and make a decision. It's immaterial to me.
Like Andrew Jackson.
In my judgment, that would be foolhardy for any person involved in litigation with the Supreme Court, including the president. So I think it's wise judgment for the president to litigate his rights up to and including the Supreme Court, which he has a right to do under our system. And then hopefully he'll win from his point of view. If he doesn't, then my judgment is that he ought to cooperate. But I don't think he in this position ought to make that judgment before the action of the court.
But you're saying then that it's proper for him to leave open the possibility that he might not choose to cooperate?
I don't think he's leaving it open. I'm simply saying he's using good judgment as a person who is involved in deep litigation, not to comment one way or another.
Miss Martha Angle is with the Washington Star News. Miss Angle.
Now, Mr. Vice President, have you at any point asked the president whether he will comply with the Supreme Court decision? Have you personally asked him?
I have not.
Why not?
I think that's a judgment for him to make. Yeah.
Well, let's assume that you get to the position where he does not comply, that the ruling goes against him and he says, I cannot comply with this. In my judgment, the executive branch of government is not subject to the will of the judicial branch. He's already said that in his judgment, the executive branch as personified by the president is not subject to the will of the Congress, that he does not need to turn over the tapes or the other material subpoenaed by the House committee because it is a separate branch of government. You're then left in the position where the Judiciary Committee has no means of obtaining the evidence it feels necessary to reach a judgment. The president has become a law unto himself. How can you then expect them to reach any kind of intelligent decision on his fate?
In the first place, I think in order to understand your question, you have to say, which is a fact, that the president has turned over a substantial number of tapes, including the most famous and probably the most crucial one, the one of March 21, 1973.
He's the one who says that's the most crucial. The committee wants others.
Well, I know that. But they have turned over better than 20 of the tapes, and they've turned over transcripts of up to the 44 that were originally asked for. Now, I happen to think that the president, number one, ought to abide by the Supreme Court decision. Number two, I think he ought to be as forthcoming as possible in making tapes available that are relevant to the impeachable provision in the Constitution. Now, the President has also, as I'm sure you know, indicated that if Mr. Rodino and Mr. Hutchinson want to come down and personally interrogate him, he will be glad to do so or to cooperate. And that if they want to submit as a committee written interrogatories for him to answer under oath, he will likewise do so. Now, they haven't exercised any of those prerogatives yet.
Are you suggesting that the chairman and the ranking minority members should substitute their judgment for the personal judgment of all 38 members of the committee? You just said earlier that every member of the House should reach a judgment on his own. Should not every member of the committee?
I think those two at least ought to exercise their opportunity. And if they then find that there is evidence that is especially important, then in my judgment, they could come back and ask for a full presentation. You know, this committee has been pretty irresponsible. It's probably been the leakiest committee in the history of the United States Congress in the area of classified information. I understand the President's reluctance to cooperate with him when classified material is given to the committee or to committee members, and they can't wait to dash out to get on television or to give the information to some member of the news media. So I can understand some reluctance on the part of the President to just turn over the keys of the White House and let the committee drive up in a truck and take anything and everything they want out of there. I don't think that's that committee's prerogative.
Mr. Frank Donatelli is the head of the Young Americans for Freedom in Washington. Mr. Donatelli.
Yes, Mr. Vice President, you have been going around the country speaking on behalf of the President to Republican audiences, et cetera, generally being looked upon by the media and by the American people at large as a defender of the President. But yet, just about a month ago, you for some reason went to California and virtually, in the words of the Washington Post anyway, saved the career of perhaps the strongest advocate of impeachment in the House, Paul McCloskey. Now, was this bad advice? Are you sorry you did this?
Let me give you the background of this. They had a Republican state convention.
Better be good, Mr. Vice President.
It was well attended and very enthusiastic, but anyhow, they had a Republican state convention in California. They asked me to come out and participate in the convention. I was asked to participate in a program that would include Pete McCloskey, John Russolo, and John Russolo is a very conservative member of the House on the Republican aisle, and a Republican candidate for the House of Representatives to replace Charlie Goobser, who's retiring. Now, the purpose of this meeting was to show that Pete McCloskey, who's quite liberal, and John Russolo, who's quite conservative, and Pete Milius, who's sort of in the middle, it would show the depth and the breadth of the Republican Party and that we were not a narrow-gauged party. And I thought, as Vice President, representing the Republican Party, that this was a good way to recruit people who had an ideological bond, even though they didn't vote the same on every possible issue. I have no apologies for that. John Russolo, I talked to him Thursday night of this week, and John Russolo thinks that it was wise for both him and me to participate. Now, if that meeting helped Pete McCloskey, I think it helped the Republican Party.
But Pete McCloskey was facing a primary challenge at that time. I mean, you must have known that an appearance by the second highest elected official in the country on behalf of one Republican candidate over another would have helped Pete McCloskey. You had no idea that that would happen?
I didn't do it for the sole purpose of helping Pete McCloskey.
But that's
I did
where it
for the
up.
Purpose of trying to assist the Republican Party in California get a broad and I think a responsible image to include people on both sides of the center of our political spectrum in the United States. I was doing as much for John Russolo
that he's facing a primary challenge.
Well, John Russolo, I'm told, has a pretty tough election coming up this fall.
Yes, but he's running against Democrats. We're talking about a Republican against a Republican.
Well, it's important to get the party. That's the part that I played.
What is the protocol here? Are you not supposed to back incumbents if they're facing a primary?
That's one principle that is often advocated, and basically it's a pretty good one. On the other hand, in this case, and this is the important thing, if we're going to survive as a party, we have to get a broader spectrum than just 10 degrees out of 360.
But shouldn't you have waited until after McCloskey at least won the primary on his own? And then if he had won, maybe you could have gone in.
This wasn't done for the purpose of helping Pete McCloskey per se.
You should
as
have
I said on the same stand, and Bill, Pete, as I remember, stood there, and Millia stood here, and John Russolo stood over here. And I made a few remarks for about 5 or 10 minutes, and I said, here's a good example of a Republican spectrum. Pete on the left, Milius on the in the center, and Russolo on the right. And my point was to illustrate that our party could
be as incoherent as the Democratic Party.
Well, I happen to think that no political party in this country can survive and be successful if it's going to have a narrow gauge view.
Well, the just since we only have a second left, Ms. Vice President, can I ask you this? Do you feel that there is an American disposition to hurt the Republican Party as a result of the public disappointment with the behavior of Mr. Nixon?
I think there has been some evidence of Republican defection because of the illegal acts or unethical acts or bad decisions of some people that he appointed. We'll have to wait and see in the broader election come November whether they are going to relate their vote to his actions personally.
Thank you, Mr. Ford. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of American University. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel.
Copy of this program, send 50 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 50 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by grants from the Laurel Foundation and the Ford Foundation.